to the first event of the 2016 Howard Zinn Book Fair. It's the first time also we're doing movies. Movies at the Howard Zinn Book Fair. We're going to try to keep it going. Thanks everyone for coming. We'd like to thank Evan, our tech guy, Jason, my friend from high school, and Zane, my cousin, basically, for coming through at the last minute with the tech stuff, and PianoFight for letting us do this, and of course, all of you for being here. It's a great thing. Can we drop the music, actually? No. So proud to be here, so proud. I've been trying to do this for a while, and the reason I wanted to do this film was because, the reason I wanted to show this was to talk about the wars in Central America in the 1980s. That were lock, stock, and barrel funded by the United States. It was not some connect the dots kind of this. It was Ronald fucking Reagan supporting literal sociopaths in Central America that were killing people. There were very few movies made by the United States about this period. Precious few movies, right? There's Salvador by Oliver Stone, which totally sucks. And there's Under Fire with Nick Nolte, which is quite good. And a couple of others made by South American filmmakers. And Haskell Wexler, who just died recently, who made Latino. But very few people tackled this subject. And with the Cold War ending, it's become this thing that people just forgot. There's movies like The Lives of Others, I don't know if you've seen that, about Germany. And it kind of allows the West to say, oh, the Cold War was this terrible thing that happened in Eastern Europe. Whereas the Cold War happened right here in our own backyard and was arguably more brutal in a certain way, but still. We have our own crosses to bear and our own sins about that, and it embarrasses me that it's been so forgotten. So, you know, that's one of the reasons I wanted to show this film, is because this was also a shamefully unpolitical time in Hollywood. Hardly anybody was making political films, I feel like, in the 1980s. And out of this, Alex Cox, and along with a group of awesome producers, the sound designer is here with us tonight, and a couple of other people associated with the film, went to Nicaragua and worked with the new revolutionary Sandinista government and made a shining example of a political film in a decidedly unpolitical period in American cinema. And so that's why we're very proud to have that here tonight. And I just want to say, you know, fair play to Alex Cox and to all of them for doing that, because in a time of darkness, I think we need to remember that we still need films, and we still need audacious films. If there was ever a time for audacious art, right, facing an audacious president.
Yes.
It's time for audacious art, for psychotronic art, for left-wing art and politics to be punk rock audacious in your face. This is the time, and I think this film perfectly represents that. Please give a warm welcome to Alex Cox.
Seen a full house for walking before. We made this film in 1987. It was made by me, by a Peruvian American Mexican producer called Lorenzo O'Brien, an American screenwriter called Rudy Wurlitzer, a Peruvian production designer and art director called Cecilia Montiel, an English camera guy called Dave Bridges, an Irish camera guy called Dennis Crossan, a Mexican cinematographer, two Nicaraguan cinematographers. The cast came from Europe, they came from the US, they came from Mexico, they came from Nicaragua. So it's a kind of multi-thing. The origin of it was that I had gone to Nicaragua in 1983 on one of those leftist tours that you can go on at the time of the first democratic election since the overthrow, well, not just since the overthrow of Somoza, but since forever, pretty much. And the Sandinistas won that election. It was certified as a fair and legitimate election, but that didn't stop the kindly American President Jimmy Carter from creating the contra-terrorist organization. So although it's convenient to always blame the Republicans for everything bad, but really the continuity of foreign policy isn't just down to the Republicans. Jimmy Carter created the Contras. Jimmy Carter created the Mujahideen. fighting in Afghanistan. We have Jimmy Carter to thank for a lot of things that we deal with still today. So it's sometimes, maybe it's wrong sometimes to blame only one political party and not see the continuity that, exists in the rest of the world. So anyway, we made this film, Walker, challenged by a couple of guys that we met on election day 1983, who said, what do you do for a living? And when we said, well, we're filmmakers, they said, come back to Nicaragua and make a movie about our reality here. And I tried to get out of that by saying, oh, you know, it's very expensive to make a movie. We just poor people like yourselves. And these guys go, no, go on, you're full of bullshit. You guys come from America, the land of money. Go back there, and if you're intelligent, you can raise money. Come back to Nicaragua and make a film about our reality. And so this is the result of that. I hope you enjoy it. I'm very grateful to David and to James and to the Literary Festival making this possible. I'm very grateful to you all for coming. And I hope that after you've seen the film, if you have any questions, I'll attempt to answer them. And the film was finished in San Francisco, so there was actually a big San Francisco component to the finishing of the film. Jules Roman, who was the post-production supervisor, can't be here tonight because she's too busy working on her current projects. Rudy, who was Joe Strummer's assistant and aide de camp throughout the process, is here tonight. Dan Wald, who was the original composer of the film before he was kicked off the movie by Joe, is here tonight. And Richard Beggs, our sound designer, is here tonight. So at the end of the screening, we'll be around and we can answer any questions that you may have. In the meantime, I hope you enjoyed the film. And I'd be very interested to see what you think of it afterwards.
$6 million.
Ooh. You know, what I've never seen the film before, what I found stunning was all the music. That's Joe Strummer, right?
Yeah.
Joe Strummer is recording here. Where did they record it? Somewhere in town,
right? Russian Hill.
Russian Hill
Records.
Wow. But you know, the sound is, I'm sure, a great respect must be given to Richard Beggs as a sound designer.
Yeah. I'm better than that.
Wait a minute. How are you better?
Well, it was a pretty amazing experience, the whole proposition. Joe was living in a freight elevator room or basement of a nap. He had made it into his little office. The picture was done in mono at Alex's insistence. And there were a number of. I spent some time in Nicaragua.
Wow.
And being on location is always a good thing to do, because there's something that happens there that informs you about the life and the spirit of the picture. There's something that you pick up and you take into post-production, which is where I spend most of my time. But if you don't make that connection with what's happening at the beginning, you sort of miss something. It was a rewarding and valuable experience. I haven't seen it for about 20 some odd years. How long has it been? When did we do this, Alex?
Nearly 30 years ago. 1987.
Yeah, I haven't seen it since then. But I'd change a few things. But aside from that, it's okay.
Wait a minute. Could you change them now?
It's possible, yeah. You could go back into it. But I don't think there's any need.
I don't know about the audience, but I just saw Donald Trump up there as Walker, you know, the psychopath in chief. But I don't know if you predicted that or anticipated or what.
Oh, y'all are so funny. How many people here identify themselves as liberals? Not a hand goes up. One, two, three, four. Well, good for you.
Hey, I do, because I'm not white.
Good for you guys. So you're grieving. You're grieving right now.
No, I'm not. I predicted him. I really did predict.
Alex, was this screening booked before or after the election?
Before.
Before.
I think if one message should come through from this film, and I'm only speaking as a foreigner, right, so I don't really belong here. I'm only here on the grace of your kindness. But for me,
our money.
For me, there is no difference between the Democratic Party and the Republican Party. And I think that we dodged a big bullet, because we were looking, if your friend, who presumably, since you're concerned about the guy who won the election, and you perhaps supported the person, one of the candidates who lost the election, one of the candidates who lost the election was looking to start a war with Russia. And once you start a war with Russia, you don't know where that's going to end. And all my life, my only real concern through my entire life has been to not die in a nuclear war. I think we dodged a bullet, you know? So that's all I can say. But no, it's not about Donald Trump at all. It's about Jimmy Carter.
I think we've forgotten him. You know, I'm sorry to say, I think we've forgotten Jimmy Carter. But maybe this gentleman hasn't in the audience.
I remember Jimmy Carter. But I was a liberal. I'm more, we can call it a, right now, a free thinker, independent, because we're in a very confusing time where the internet is full of so much misinformation from all sides. That, like what Anton Mosel said years ago, you have to take the time to investigate. And most people don't have the time to research every single article and investigate, because they have jobs. If they were independently wealthy, they could probably investigate.
But you know, I'm not going to interrupt you. I want to come back, because right now, I'm in this debate with people who are doing an Anton Wilson project. And Anton Wilson is one of the first fake news guys, because what he did was he merged interesting and true stuff that, like, Mark Lane and other people were unearthing about the Kennedy assassination with entire fantasy stuff, you know. So if ever there was an obfuscator and a fake news guy, it would be Robert Anton Wilson and the Illuminati trilogy, wouldn't it?
But in that whole trilogy, what he would always preface is, do not believe anything I say, investigate for yourself. Read all of the news articles and investigate and find out what is true and decide the truth for yourself. He was a person who just basically wanted people to think for themselves. You know, and that was what he had always stated in all his books, even his books with Timothy Leary. But that's not my question. My question about Walker is, you must have done some research on Walker. Now, Walker was from the South, and I believe he was a lawyer and even at one time a physician early on. Okay. What I'm a little bit confused about is, did he really get support from Vanderbilt, or did he come to San Francisco and get a ragtag group of guys together who had sort of failed during the gold rush, and promised them land and to have their own country someday. And is that how he got his men together, or was he actually financed by them?
Because we do a lot of, I mean, because the film isn't true, obviously. We do a lot of merging, you know. The stuff that happens in the film is mostly true, but a lot of the things that happened, Walker's relationship with Ellen Martin, who's played by Marley Matlin in the film, actually happened in Tennessee. He was based in Tennessee before he came to San Francisco, so we compressed all of that, put it all in San Francisco. And so I believe he was funded by Vanderbilt at the outset, because Vanderbilt was the originator of the idea of digging a canal across Nicaragua, which until recently was also a Chinese plan, which seems to have gone into remission now. But a year ago, there was a Chinese businessman who supposedly had huge funds, and they were going to redig the canal. So that was Vanderbilt's goal, to create a swift transit route across Central America via Nicaragua. And where Walker went wrong or lost his way, as far as he and his supporters were concerned, was when he switched his allegiance from Vanderbilt's transit company to the company of Garrison and Morgan, who are the other two guys that show up down there and are then humiliated by Vanderbilt. So as far as I'm aware, that is part of the historical record. He was initially funded by Vanderbilt, and then he lost Vanderbilt's support, and that's when Vanderbilt essentially brought him down by switching his allegiance to the oligarchical forces in the
interior. There's something in the record that Vanderbilt had funded at some point.
You'd have to get into the books. I mean, you'd have to go back to Thomas Z. Carr and to the filibuster and stuff. Because when we did, when Rudy and I went through all those books, Rudy was the screenwriter. I think that he was the funder of Walker, but I mean, you could go into the historical record and prove me wrong.
The people who became the soldiers, they were from San Francisco. They were old 49ers.
They were old 49ers, exactly. They were guys who the Coleman played out for them, and they were looking for something else to do. And there was this mission that they could go on. But when we start with Walker in Mexico, where he had another band of guys who failed on their mission, and they were trying to take over Mexico, and it was slightly before the Gadsden Purchase. So Walker was always on the cusp of things, on the cusp of Manifest Destiny. But sometimes he was a bit ahead of the game, and that could be as bad as, you know, as Vanderbilt says, you know, nobody remembers men who lose. Right. You know, even though he was so important at the time, there was more press given to Walker than to either of the presidents in the time in which he operated. So he was a very important person then.
Oh, you know, that reminds me, did somebody say that Rudy Wurlitzer is in this room?
What?
Did someone say that earlier?
He did, if he is.
Oh, okay. I could have sworn someone said it.
I think he's in Hudson, New York. He's here in spirit, but he's not dead yet either.
Question over here. It's kind of a two-parter. This is my second time seeing the film, and it bears multiple rewatchings, I feel. It's got that later Alden-esque kind of thing there, the dialogue, you know, builds and comes back and really kicks in the butt. But my first question was Peckinpah's Pat Garrett and Billy the Kid an influence at all on this film for you? Because that's another one of my favorite films. And on the rewatch, I was getting a lot more of that. So that's part A. And part B is any memories of Wurlitzer you have, because he's a personal god of mine. So two parts.
Well, I mean, I asked Rudy to write it because he'd written Pat Garrett and Billy the Kid, you know, because Pat Garrett and Billy the Kid seemed to me to be a story about these two guys who are really seeking their own deaths, but the only way they can do it is by climbing up on a pile of bodies and then falling off, you know, and that's what Walker does as well. So it seemed like a perfect script for Rudy to write. But then when I got to know him, and he came down to Nicaragua while we were there, and experienced the place a little bit. I mean, it just seemed like he was so perfect. So, has anybody seen Pat Garrett, Billy the Kid?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's the most political Western ever made, and I think it's just a fantastic film. Very deserving of repeated viewings, you know. I think that Pat Garrett, Billy the Kid, and this are his two best screenplays, I think. Yeah.
Easily.
How much of the $5 million was spent in Nicaragua? Did you meet Daniel Ortega? Was he part of the, you know, helping out in any way with government there?
I never met Daniel Ortega. We spent most of the money in Nicaragua, but not all of it, because a lot of it got, some of it, or a fair amount of it got spent on salaries and Mexican crew and renting equipment in Mexico and bringing it into Nicaragua because they didn't have a 35mm infrastructure there. But I didn't meet Daniel Ortega, but we were involved with other people in the Sandinista directorate, including Thomas Borges, Sergio Ramirez, other people in the directorate, but we were never involved. There was a break in the cultural sector. Ortega and his wife had their own cultural organization, but there was also the cultural organization of Ernesto Cardenal, and we were involved with the Ernesto Cardenal side of the thing with Imcine, and so we weren't involved with them, but we were involved with other people in that process, and all kinds of different social groups in Nicaragua, including the Catholic Church, who lent us the cathedral in Managua to set on fire.
Okay, David.
Can you talk a little bit about the times and what it was like, and why you decided to make a film in Nicaragua, and why this happened at the time, and a little bit about Ernesto Cardenal?
The poet, by the way.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I had the mistaken view that you could involve yourself in other people's countries and have something to say there, which is completely wrong. You know, I mean, I feel now you should just stay out of the whole thing and not mess with people. You know, but I was younger and more foolish then, and it seemed like a very good project, a very worthwhile project, the Nicaraguan Revolution. But as Susan Micellus, you know Susan Micellus, the photographer, when she...
Oh yeah, I have her book.
Yeah, she said that when the project was defeated, when the United States invaded Panama, and that was a message to the Nicaraguans that they'd better vote the Sandinistas out of office, and indeed they did, and 10 years of like privation and suffering came in, it was easy for us, the gringos, to get the hell out, you know, and go and pursue our other fantasies. You know, for us, it was kind of like a golden dream, you know. But for the Nicaraguans, it was much more serious. And so I think what she said was quite true, and I think the message for me is just like, just don't mess with other people's business, you know, which is why I even hesitate to say anything to Americans, because I'm just a foreigner, you know. I mean, you guys know better than I do what should be.
You know, wait a minute. I want to take advantage of Richard Beggs being here. This man.
Yeah, this man's take advantage genius. Of Richard.
This man's a genius, and he is almost single-handedly, at least in my history book, invented the word and the concept of sound design. And can you tell us what sound design is and what you did in the film we just saw? Because I think the sound is fantastic, or the music, or both. I can't make a distinction between the two.
Well, sound works in a more oblique, sort of subtle way. People are aware of music. They know that what music connotes. Sound is sort of this strange, mysterious thing that we sort of take for granted. We never know when it's working on us or not. And one of the things I enjoy about what I do is I can manipulate people without them really being conscious of it. Conscious, when music is, telegraphing is the wrong word, but bad movies, music telegraphs. But sound has this ability to work in a very subtle, subconscious way. And Alex's picture has this sort of strange, I won't say it's detached, but it sort of barely holds on to the surface of the planet in a way. And it creates this sort of, there's a limbo in it that allows you to play around a lot. And so I chose to not play up the action sequences in a conventional way. They almost always have this sort of dreamy, unreal quality. that to me reflected Walker's state of mind, that kind of thing. I mean, this was, what, almost 30 years ago?
Yeah, 87. 87,
right. And I was only...
21 years old.
I was, what, 10 years into my career, maybe 8. And so this was an early effort for me, the other things I had done. And but it was very, very fertile ground, developing a set of ideas and a style. I'm thankful that there are directors like Alex who sort of have a tremendous capacity to give people latitude to be, to stick their neck out, to take chances, and to fail. I mean, there's some things in here that I'm really not happy with, but he always had smiled and sort of accepted whatever it was I came up with.
I mean, the great gift that Richard gave to the film was to do it in mono, because at this point we weren't into like 5 or 7.1 or anything like that in those days, but there was the choice between doing a mono or a two-channel stereo mix. And we had gone to Nicaragua with a print of Sid and Nancy, which was made in stereo. I played it to people in Nicaragua over a mono system, and it sounded so god-awful. And I just thought, if you make this film in mono, it'll play in any cinema in the world and it will sound all right. And that's probably still true, right? If you had a mono track, it's just going to default to all the speakers, right?
No, that's not true, Alex.
Shit!
We've done, I think, two of the things we've done have been in mono.
Yeah, we had Three Businessmen in mono.
Three Businessmen in mono, too. Yeah. That's an interesting exercise. It's both frustrating and sort of liberating. It allows you to think about other things.
In that first part when they come into Nicaragua and have the first war, when the men are attacking Rumba, that was the most thrilling sequence, really.
Yeah.
And was that like supplied? Were there effects supplied? Or did you just do that in the mixer? I mean, or was that your...
No, you built it all, right? You must have built... It was just Joe Strummer's music and the effects that you built for that first battle.
So it's just like standard effects that you echoed them out. Was that your...
Yeah, that was my take. It seemed more believable... It made the movie, to me, more believable than if it was literally... You tried to do what you were actually seeing.
Because I think what you wouldn't hear now, you wouldn't hear a battle sequence like that anymore, because now the goal is just to put everything in there. It's like the mixing. There's a philosophy of mixing now with music too, isn't it, where everything is the same volume. So even the quiet things are like really loud, and the volume is generally equal. Whereas what goes on in that battle scene is sometimes it gets really quiet, really minimal, and then builds up again. So it's kind of an old style of sound design and mixing that doesn't seem to happen anymore.
The issue is serving the image, and I don't want to use the word message, but there's a germ of an idea, there's a sensibility that exists. It existed on location when Alex was there, and you connect with that and try just to follow through. Hopefully it works.
This guy up here.
How are you? Oh,
I can't be here.
Oh, you know, I want to ask a question. God damn it.
No, I'm just kidding.
I remember hearing about you ages ago before the internet, and I swear it was always in context of punk rock. But I went online and I couldn't find the references that I thought I remembered. I mean, you got all these punk rockers to trust you with their music and give you stuff. I mean, there's got to be some punk rock connection behind formation of your philosophy, I think, even. You know, you're not making an establishment film in it here, you know. You're a rebel of some kind.
Well, I mean, I think the idea of the punk rock thing, right, was that you could make your own music.
Yes.
And you didn't need the record company. And I think that what we were trying to do, even though this film was funded by Universal Pictures in the end, but that was never our intention at the outset. Our intention was just to make a good film about this subject and try not to involve a studio or a big financier if it was possible. And I imagine that was the goal of the original, you know, the original punks, although ironically, of course, the
Sex Pistols. Well, do it yourself, yeah.
Yeah, but although then the Sex Pistols and the Clash were masters of playing these big record companies, or imagining that they were playing the big record companies. But it did seem, towards the end, it did seem like, in a way, that Joe was being a bit controlled by capital, that in a way, or by Virgin, that he could never quite escape from the control of those.
Joe Strummer, you mean?
Yeah. That he could create the music, but in terms of reaching the public, the music, that was more difficult because they literally controlled the release date of the album, and they wouldn't release the album when the film came out, and they didn't support him at all. And so it was interesting to see somebody who was such a consummate artist and musician and punk, you know, punk artist, still struggling with a big corporation. You know, that was interesting.
Yeah, but I want to know about your personal encounters with punk ages ago. I feel that they must have shaped who you became. You know, ethics, whatever you call it, independence, you know, black humor, you know, against authority.
Oh, I like that already. I mean, that was just, I'm just fitted with that, you know. But I mean, I do think, I mean, I used to, when we were in Los Angeles, I mean, Dan is here, we used to go to like shows all the time, you know, we were like constantly at like the Starwood and seeing Fear and the Circle Jerks and Suicidal Tendencies, 999, Please. Not the Police, 999. The real punk. Yeah, but that was just music, you know. I mean, it's a mistake to think that. It's like Buñuel said, you know, Buñuel said that surrealism was intended to be not just a way of selling paintings, right, but a lifestyle and an existence and a form of rebellion against authority. And it completely failed. And in the same way, punk also completely failed and became merely a fashion statement. So you gotta exist beyond these things that come.
Well, I hate labels, but I still think punk has got legs, because I meet kids, the kids of friends of mine who are starting punk bands. So something in terms of principles has not died.
That's great.
Smells bad.
Well, Richard. I know you've got something else to enlighten us with.
Not really.
Tell me back here a question, Jeff.
Okay, one last question.
This guy.
Wait, there's a person of color, man, up there in black. You, with the glasses, you had your hand up. Well, what were you going to ask?
I was just wondering how it was working with Joe Strummer in the two movies that you were. Straight to Hell and Walker. And you had
the
interesting stories of you two together in Nicaragua.
You know, the person who should tell the stories about Joe Strummer is Jules Roman, who's not here tonight, because Jules Roman was our post-production like leader here in San Francisco. And she was the person who had to like lead Joe to the studio and get him the musicians that supported him in the show But unfortunately, she's working really hard, isn't he, tonight? Rudy, Joe's partner for many years, is here tonight. Rudy, where are you? What was it like working with Joe Strummer?
He's my cousin, sorry.
Oh, he's your cousin? You already know.
It was great. I mean, I was reading film comment where Joe Strummer was giving you he said he loved working with you because you were uncorrupted. Hollywood hadn't corrupted you. Because you were new, and so he felt that you still have this freedom for work and with the original.
You know, and I think that's interesting because what I did feel about him was he had the most amazing creative talent, but because they got into the Clash when they were in their early 20s, right? They had also got into a world of politics, and they'd also learned very early on to be very political. And that's a tough row to hoe, you know, because it takes an impact on you, you know, and it has an effect on what you do and on your creativity. And I was lucky because I never had the success that Joe and Simonon and the other guys in the Clash had. So I never could become corrupted in that way. And I think that Joe had to deal with the corrupting process of great success. The money was pouring in from the Clash library. He didn't need to work. He lived a comfortable existence in the country, you know. But where was the art? Where was the work? Where was the creativity? Where was the revolution, you know? Whereas if you don't have a full-time salary, then you really have to keep at it, you know? So, I don't know.
Wow, success brings what?
Failure.
I think we're all gonna be around. Can we just give a pitch for the Howard?
Oh yeah, hold on, it's coming. Okay, it's almost exact. I was going to do it at 10:25, David. I'm on top of it.
My one anecdote about Alex and Hollywood, it's a small thing, but we were, I don't know why I was there, we were on the Universal lot. I guess we'd gone together, and we parked in the parking lot, and they have these elephant trains, people, you know, get on them, and they take tours of the studio, and it was pretty empty except a distant elephant train, and Alex said something like, "Watch this," and he went down this row of cars and you hit them, he banged on them really hard with his hand, and it would set off their alarms. And then we were walking through the lot and he had three cars going with the alarms, and you know, people were looking around, what's wrong, but this was like, this was very emblematic of Alex's relationship with the industry, which was sort of terminated briefly after this.
Terminated after what was completed, yeah, because, I mean, it's amazing when you read this stuff about the Hollywood blacklist, this thing that used to exist in the 1950s.
I mean, he was a loose cannon, the bad boy of Hollywood. Or people who are determined to never have to let you make a picture again.
Yeah. Amazing. And I have to bring things back to punk because I am the publisher of Search and Destroy, the first San Francisco punk publication.
Excellent.
Started in 1976. I actually have to tell you, I've got a few copies for sale of my stuff. I have to give that pitch because, you know, I'm not rich, just like Alex here. But I promised David that I would remind you that in just 4 days, there's a great Howard Zinn Book Fair, and it's free, and please find the book, just Google Howard Zinn Book Fair, and find all the details, and please attend. I have to say, I will have a table there too, and I want to thank, you know, David Martinez, and where is he? James Tracy.
James Tracy.
And also the owners of this venue were in for giving James and David a good deal.
And you know, while we were doing this, they're doing King Lear out there. This is like a high creativity hour. So that's great.
Well, Alice, is it easy to buy your stuff or does anyone do that anymore? They just download it, right?
Yeah, just get it for free off the internet, you file.
Oh, well, he is running a Kickstarter campaign for future books, so...
Tell us about your new movie. Yeah. Tell us about your new movie.
Yeah, the new movie.
Well, I'm finishing a film which Tippett Studios have just done four visual effects for big time matte paintings. Dan Wall has composed the music for. Richard was going to be the sound designer, but was caught up with other projects and wasn't able to do so, but we're going to be still looking for his advice and counsel on the project. And it's called Tombstone Rashomon. and it's about the gunfight at the OK Corral from six different points of view. I live in Southern Oregon and I work in Southern Arizona.
Wow.
All right.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks everyone for coming so much.